I'm Dennis Morris. I'm a mathematician and theoretical physicist. This is the second video in the series of videos about quaternions. In this video, we will be looking at rotation in quaternion space, and we will be looking at quaternion differentiation. We will also look at the quaternion inner product. We have the two algebraic matrix forms of the quaternions. What do you do with an algebraic matrix form? You do what any decent person would do. You take the exponential. We have used the left chiral quaternions here. The right chiral quaternions give a very similar result. This is the polar form of the left chiral quaternion. The matrix on the right is the left chiral quaternion rotation matrix. Functions within the rotation matrix are the left chiral quaternion trigonometric function. These left chiral quaternion trigonometric functions are identical to the right chiral quaternion trigonometric functions. The chirality is in the distribution of minus signs within the matrix. Notice that the argument of the trigonometric functions is comprised of three variables. This is a four-dimensional angle. This is four-dimensional rotation. The quaternion trigonometric functions have been known since 1845. They were first published by Cayley, though Cayley attributed them to Hamilton. Actually, that's not quite true. The notation used by Cayley was so obscure that no one realized that these were four-dimensional trigonometric functions, and no one realized that the quaternions had a four-dimensional angle. That's right. This is four-dimensional space, but it is nothing like the four-dimensional space-time of our universe. Quaternion space has only one rotation in it, only one angle. Our four-dimensional space-time has six rotations, three of each type, and they're all two-dimensional. Quaternion space is weird. Oh, I forgot to tell you, quaternion rotation is not rotation about an axis. All the eigenvectors vary with the angle. Of course they do. This is four-dimensional rotation in a four-dimensional space. It is not rotation about an axis. The determinant of the rotation matrix is 1. All rotation matrices have determinant unity. We have a quaternion trigonometric identity. Suppose within the quaternion rotation matrix we set two of the imaginary variables to zero. Now, this is more familiar. This is very similar to the two-dimensional rotation we have in the Euclidean complex numbers. We need to be careful. This is still a four-dimensional rotation. Looking at the position of the minus signs, we see that this is a rotation in both directions at once. This is a rotation that is both clockwise and anticlockwise at the same time. That's unusual.
This is four-dimensional rotation. It is not the same as the two-dimensional rotation to which we are used.
Looking at the traditional notation for quaternions, you might think that a quaternion with two zero imaginary variables is just a complex number. It is not. The notation is misleading. It is often said that quaternions have three two-dimensional subalgebras which are each a copy of the complex numbers. That is wrong. The notation is misleading you. I told you that matrix notation is best. The quaternions do have three subalgebras, and each of these subalgebras is algebraically isomorphic to the complex numbers. But they're not the complex numbers. Algebraic isomorphism isn't everything. These are four-dimensional, two-dimensional subalgebras. In the same way that the quaternion rotation is four-dimensional, two-dimensional rotation. The reason the quaternions have three subalgebras is because the finite group C2 cross C2 has three C2 subgroups. Back to rotation. We see that the double rotation is comprised of two rotations in the same direction. This is twice as much rotation as we are used to.
If you feel confused and disheartened by all this, you are normal. Even the most intelligent people find these kinds of rotations quite dizzying. The electron has twice the magnetic dipole moment that we would expect it to have if it was rotating in two-dimensional Euclidean space. This property of having twice as much magnetic dipole moment as it ought to have has puzzled physicists for over 100 years. We see that the problem is solved immediately if we allow that electrons rotate in quaternion space. To reiterate, quaternion rotation is four-dimensional rotation. Even when it's reduced by making two variables zero, it's still four-dimensional rotation. Things get even more unusual.
The quaternions are not commutative. This means that if we apply the rotation matrix to the left, we get a result which is different from the result we get if we apply the rotation matrix to the right.
We will now look at differentiation within the quaternions. When we form a derivative, we form a ratio dy divided by dx. In a commutative algebra, dy divided by dx is unambiguous.
Within a non-commutative algebra, the ratio of dy divided by dx is ambiguous. Do we mean 1 over dx multiplied by dy, or do we mean dy multiplied by 1 over dx?
Within the quaternions, we have three algebraic operations. We have addition, multiplication, and the commutator. Will that help? Yes, it will. But first, I must explain the differential operator to you.
This is the left chiral differential operator. It is the operator we use within the left chiral quaternion algebra. There is a similar but slightly different right chiral quaternion differential operator, which we use within the right chiral quaternion algebra.
Strictly speaking, there is no such thing as an operator within an algebra. What we actually have in the differential operator is a shortcut, a quick and easy way to differentiate properly. But the operators don't really exist in algebras. If you are interested, the details of how the differential operator within quaternion space is derived are to be found in my book, The Physics of Empty Space. I'm afraid the derivation is rather tedious, rather laborious, with big matrices everywhere, but it's there if you want it.
First, a general point. From this point onward, the matrices get too large to fit easily onto the screen. However, each matrix is a left chiral quaternion. And so, if we know the four elements in the left-hand column, we can reconstruct the entire matrix by copying these four elements into the other places in the matrix. We have to watch the signs carefully. Now to this slide. We act with the differential operator as if by matrix multiplication. Here we have the differential operator acting from the left. We denote this by D subscript L. We can similarly act with the differential operator on the right. We denote this by D subscript R.
This is where the commutator comes in. We also use the anti-commutator.
We form two differentials which we call the E field and the B field. These are both quaternion matrices. This is non-commutative differentiation. We can do this only because the commutator exists within the quaternion algebra.
When you were watching the previous video, perhaps you wondered why I rattled on so much about the commutator being an algebraic operation. This is the answer. Differentiation. That is the reason the commutator is so important.
This is the quaternion E field. Viewers familiar with electromagnetism we'll recognize this as the electric field. This is the quaternion B field. Viewers familiar with electromagnetism will recognize this as the magnetic field.
We can do the same within the right chiral quaternions. That is how you differentiate within quaternions. There is an ambiguity about how you define the B field, but all that comes down to is the direction that you assign to the field. Yes, before you ask, Maxwell's equations of electromagnetism do fall out of the quaternions through non-commutative differentiation. Thank you. out of curiosity, let us differentiate the quaternion rotation matrix. So that we know what to expect, we will first differentiate the two-dimensional complex number rotation matrix.
We see that the complex number rotation matrix has differentiated to itself. How about the quaternion rotation matrix? What happens when we differentiate that? We can copy the E field directly from above, just substituting in the trigonometric function. Calculating the differentials gives this. We get the rotation matrix. The B field of the rotation matrix is 0.
We see that the E field is the rotation matrix. The quaternion rotation matrix is differentiated to itself, as it should do. The B field is 0. You might have been a little unsure about non-commutative differentiation when I first showed it to you, but it does get the right results. It gets Maxwell's equations, it differentiates the rotation matrix properly. Supposing we use the commutator to rotate, we would get an E rotation and a B rotation.
We will rotate this vector in quaternion space using this rotation matrix. We will form the E rotation and the B rotation. We have just copied the anti-commutator operation and the commutator operation. We see that if we use the commutator rotation, we get a unique rotation within quaternion space.
We also get a B rotation. Again, this is 0 if the rotation angle is 0. But the B rotation is also 0 if the vector and the rotation are collinear in the sense shown. Are there trigonometric identities associated with the commutator rotation? We will first look at the complex numbers. Note that we achieve conjugation by reversing the sign of the angle. That is what conjugation is. If we normalize a complex number, we can put it equal to a rotation matrix. We can multiply a complex number by the conjugate of a different complex number. This is the result. We see that multiplying the two rotation matrices together gives the cosine of the angle between the two complex numbers and the sine of the angle between the two complex numbers. We have the inner product of the two-dimensional Euclidean complex numbers. The inner product is the real part of the complex number. We also have the magnitude of the cross product, but that is not our main concern here.
We can do this with the inner product in quaternions because the real part of the quaternion is the same regardless of the order of multiplying two quaternions together.
This, the real part of the quaternion, is the same regardless of the order of multiplication. The imaginary parts of the quaternion differ with the order of multiplication. We multiply two rotation matrices together. Note that one of the matrices is conjugated. This is the product. The real part of this is unambiguous because the real part of the quaternion is the same regardless of the order of multiplication.
We can put the real parts equal to the inner product.
Now the product of two rotation matrices is a rotation matrix. And so the real part of the product of two rotation matrices can be put equal to the cosine of a quaternion angle. We have the quaternion inner product. The product of two quaternion rotation matrices is a quaternion rotation matrix. And so we can put the real part equal to the cosine mu for some quaternion angle mu. In the three imaginary identities, there is an ambiguity due to the non-commutative nature of the quaternion. Within the complex numbers, the angle mu is simply the difference between the two angles. We would like to think that this is also the case within quaternion space, but it is not obvious that this is true. We do not yet have an expression for the angle mu in the quaternion.
Well, we did not get the expression for mu that we had hoped for. Have we done something wrong? Let us try this with the commutator rotation. Let us look at the E rotation that we saw earlier.
First, we take the E product, that's the anti-commutator, of two quaternions. Notice that we have conjugated one of the quaternions. In due course, we will normalize this product. Second, we take the E rotation of two different rotation matrices. Notice that we have conjugated the second rotation matrix. By this, we mean that we have reversed the sign of all three of the angle variables. This is the result. It leads to the same inner product. Of course, it leads to the same inner product because the real part of a quaternion is commutative. Again, we can put this equal to cosine mu, but again, we do not know the expression for the angle. We note that this will reduce to the complex number inner product when two of the variables are zero. We have some quaternion e-rotation identities. But we do not have an expression for the quaternion angle mu.
This series of two videos has been nothing more than an introduction to quaternions. We've seen that the quaternions derive from the finite group C2 cross C2. We've seen that there are two types of quaternions, the left chiral and the right chiral. We have seen that there is a third algebraic operation, the commutator, within the quaternions. We have met non-commutative differentiation. But there is much more to quaternions than what we have covered in these two videos. I hope you will go on to study them further. This has been only an introduction. In another video which we intend to produce, we will rewrite the Dirac equation using quaternions to form the quaternion Dirac equation. There is also much more in quaternions to be done. For example, no one has attempted to do Fourier analysis with the quaternion trigonometric functions. Indeed, the trigonometric functions of quaternions and all the higher dimensional algebras are virtually unexplored. We have now come to the end of this series of videos. Please allow me to advertise some of the books I have written. Thank you for your attention.